Peace be unto Jesus.
Jesus, Jesus. Praise the Lord, everybody. Hallelujah to you. Oh, glory. Oh, thank you, Jesus. Praise the Lord, everybody. Woo. Oh, it doesn't get old. It doesn't get old. I know that they have said 6 feet, and this is about 6 feet, but I am thankful. I'm thankful for a God. All you got to do is call his name, and he's closer than the mention of his name. So this right here, you just say Jesus, and it doesn't apply. It doesn't apply. Woo! So look to your neighbor. Look to your neighbor and say, I don't know what you came to do, but I have come to praise the Lord. Woo! Oh, you know, normally we start out with an action song to warm you up, but y'all look pretty warm to me. So we are going to have Addison step up this morning, and she is going to introduce the action song for you warmed up people.
So this action song is called Me Without You.
Step up right here so people in the back can see you. I don't think anybody's going to be sitting down today.
This song is called Me Without You, and we're going to start off with the verse. So raindrops rolling off my brim. Street lights got the pavement glistening.
Yeah.
Touchdown, I fall into your arms, right where I belong, your everlasting arms. Where would I be without you? Now we're going to go into the chorus. I'd be packing my bags when I need to stay. I'd be chasing every breeze that blows my way. I'd be building my kingdom just to watch it fade away. It's true. That's me without you. We're going to do the bridge real quick.
Second verse?
Oh, yes. Second verse. So you cross your legs together, and you do a spin. It says flashback. If you want to do the modified version, you can go to my mom or Sister Debbie. Yeah, Okay. Step into the scene. There's you, and there's a very different me. Touchdown. You had me at believe. You had me at believe. You did. Now the bridge. You rescued me. You are mine. I am yours. You rescued me. I am yours forever. You saved me, remade me. Where would I be? And that's it. That's it. You do the chorus again? Okay. All right, chorus one more time. Chorus, okay. I'd be packing my bags when I need to stay. I'd be chasing every breeze that blows my way. I'd be building my kingdom just to watch it fade away. It's true. That's me without you.
Whatever you feel. Just go with it. More than likely, I don't even know if I might do my own thing. You never know. So everybody good? We ready to go? All right, sound man, let's kick this pig.
Raindrops rolling off my brim. Street lights got the pavement glistening. Touchdown, I fall into your arms, right where I belong.
every breeze that blows my way. I've been building my kingdom just to watch it fade away. It's true, that's me without you.
Be 6 foot, isn't that something that you know, 6 feet is the distance to keep dead things away from you. Isn't that something? Yeah, I see a lot of live things here. I see a lot of life. I see born again. My God. Whew. My Jesus. All right, we have another, I think Tommy here today? I think Tommy, he stepped out of quarantine today. Yeah, but he doesn't quarantine from coronavirus. It's more dust mites and, you know, things like that. But Tommy is going to be here today, and he is going to be singing I Am a Christian. How many Christians we have here today? What does it take to be a Christian? Christian, to be a Christian is to be Christ-like, to be like Jesus. So, do we have evidence in our life? Do we? That's right. In Jesus' name. Okay, so, oh, y'all are waiting on me. That's right. My bad. They're going to do some motions with this as well. She's going to do them first. Or just do your own thing. Whatever you feel, Brother David. Brother Davis, he's got like this, I've seen this move, he was on the roof. I don't know if he was slipping or if he just felt something. Okay, let me see if I got this right. Okay, here we go. Tommy, you ready? Oh, you know what? It's my fault. My bad. My bad. Sister Tina, why don't you testify?
told me that if I see people in the store, they don't want me near them, so I'm praying for them afar. And all of them have been receptive. And one of them repeated me in Jesus' name about 3 or 4 times. I don't know if you can tell about Jesus. He won't let me near him. But it's okay that I prayed for 3 or 4 people. I was scared to pray. Praying was not one of my better assets. But, you know, the Lord saved me from something that could have killed me. It took my house, but it didn't take my son. Take me. And I want to thank every one of you guys that came to clear the place off. They didn't have to. They did it because they did what God told them to do. And I wanted them all to stand, but I don't think some of them aren't even in here. So you tell them that I said thank you, Brother James. I want to thank Brother James. He's made sure the crew was there for me. And I want to thank Brother Jerry in the time when I was watching the house fall down and know how to deal with it, and Brother Clark, maybe 2 times. And I left the property. I thought they were through the mail. But anyway, I just want to thank you men. And I want all the ladies that came, if you would, to stand too. I know Sister Melanie was there. And I know Sister Anne was there. And Sister, I didn't see you back there. You're usually over there. Sister Rachel.
Tanya.
Yes, Tanya. Tanya lent her husband. Didn't even have it but 1 more day. And he came over the first thing and helped us get the cars out. Those cars up under that thing, they tried to jack them up. They jumped them off. And I want to thank him for taking his time to do that. And you tell him that for me, please. I want to thank your grandma. She couldn't stand. And she sat there and packed up dishes for me. Yes. And I want to thank Sister Anne for the meal that she bought for the men. And all the phone calls I got and text, Shane called me, and a bunch of people called me. But next to God, I really want to thank our pastor. Y'all have the best pastor in the world. I prayed about my house. I prayed about my son during all this. My son said, "You didn't know it, Mom, and I never told you." But I asked the Lord to please help him quit drinking, especially. And it made him sick to drink. He doesn't drink anymore. He doesn't even look at a beer. He had a nightmare about beer, which is a good sign. God is working on him. When the storm was going on, he was in the tub praying, "God, please help me. Please save me." He knows how to pray in Jesus' name. If I forget a man at the table, he says, "Mom, you're not good." I said, "Okay, amen." He listens to me pray, and he listens to the Bible reading to me. And I really thank y'all for praying for him. I know it's a long speech, but I'm so thankful that the Lord has shown me some things. Sister Sharon was one of the ones calling me all the time. She would have a phone, and she called me, you know, at any power. And she said, "I've only got 10 or 15%. And she called me constantly, and I want to thank everyone that texted her.
Yes.
I don't see Sister Paige, but and everyone that didn't have my number that called me or texted me, I want to text somebody.
Someone was praying for
it. Everybody was praying. And I appreciate y'all so much. Y'all are my family.
Yes.
My family.
Hallelujah.
This is our family. This is part of our family. We're family first. We all.
great when you really make it feel.
Amen.
Thank God for it. All right, I think.
All right.
Is in action now.
Yeah. All right. So how many of y'all are missing school? Are you? How many? You missing? Yeah. I figured more. I'd have more parents missing school. You know, I loved going to school because for me, it was 8 hours of the day that I didn't have to do laundry. I didn't have to clean anything. It was just like a free time at school. You know, and my dad, he always said, work before play. You work before you play. Get all your work done, then you can go play. You know, my mom, she always said, no, stop that. Leave her alone. Get over here. That's pretty much sums up what my mother said, yeah. You know, but serving God should be a pleasure. You know, you wake up with God on your mind. It shouldn't be a dread. It shouldn't be something that you're like, oh, I got to go to church today. I know nobody's like that today. You know, but, you know, it shouldn't be. Serving God is a wonderful thing. Okay, so the yellow is going to represent, you know, the things of God. And the blue, that's going to represent things of the world or things that we put ahead of God. Okay, so what I'm going to talk about today is putting God first. Starting your day out right. Okay, so what would be some good things to start your day with God? Prayer. Prayer is a good thing to start with God. What about anything else? Reading the Bible. That's a good one right there. Anybody? Yes. The right music, Christian music. Living a godly life. Obeying God's commandments. That would be something to start your day with, okay? And the blue, this is going to represent things of the world or things that we put ahead of God, which, you know, thou shalt not have anything before me. Anybody know that one? Okay, so what would be some of these things? TV, movies. Did you know that the average person watches about 15 years of television? That's not including iPad. That's not including cell phone. So if I were 15 years, Addison, you're 12? Yes, Addison is 12, and I knew that. And I knew that. I was just seeing, she's been out of school for a while. I was just refreshing her brain. But at home, 15 years, just, you know, I wouldn't even know who this girl was. I would just know that this is the girl that's standing in front of me while I'm trying to watch my show. You know, so what about work? Work is one of those things. You know, I'm guilty of that. I wake up with so many things on my mind that I've got to get done. I have to get this wrapped up. And before, you know, you just wake up mind rolling. Okay, so how many times during this did you pull up a YouTube to watch a puppet show? Or maybe to get on Facebook Live to watch the greatest pastor ever preach, and you pull it up and you got distracted by an ad. Or you said, oh, I haven't talked to this person in a long time. So you clicked on them, you started scrolling through, and then 2 hours later, it's just gone. You know, there's so many set hours in a day. You know, we need to get our priorities and set those in order. So, okay, we're going to attempt. Okay, what we're going to do is we're going to take the things of God and we're going to put them on the bottom, and we're going to take everything that we want to do, the lives that we want to live, the important things that we think are more important than God, and we're going to put them above God, and we're going to see if people can still see God in our lives. Because I'm a Christian. You know, I'm a Christian. You know, so does that make me a Christian because I say I'm a Christian? If I say, if I come up to you and I smell like a pig, but I said, I just took a shower. You're going to say, I don't think he took a shower. But I said I took a shower, so that means that I'm clean, right? Even though I smell like a pig? No, so just because you say you're something doesn't mean that you are something. So, oh God. We are going to put the things of the world above God. Okay. Okay. Okay, come on. Brother Hargrave, you got flood insurance? Okay. If you got. Okay. The things of God. Let's see if we can still see God in our lives. What's going on? Wait, it's mixing up. What? It is making green. Because blue and yellow make. So where's God at? I'm a Christian. So whenever we put worldly things ahead of God, let's say we get too busy. Okay, we wake up busy. Okay, and then, you know, we don't have time. We start filling this time up with stuff. Or by the end of the day, I'm just too tired. I'll get to it tomorrow, Pastor. I will. But, okay, so what if, who is the man after God's own heart?
David.
And you know, David, this is one of the qualities, I think, that made him a man after God's own heart. David, it said in Psalm 63, oh God, you are my God. Early will I seek thee. Early will I seek you. I think that's one of the things that made him a man after God's own heart. So if we take God and put him in his rightful place above everything else in our lives, will people see God in my life? So if my priorities are straight, you should still be able to see God working in my life. Not only can I see him and feel him in my life, but you shouldn't just take my word for it that I'm a Christian, that I live for God. You should be able to walk up to me and say, you're a Christian. I see God working in your life. You are a Christian because I see God moving in your life. So putting God first. So when we put God first in our life, everything stays aligned, everything stays clear, everything stays focused. And not only can we see God living and working in our lives, but everybody else can too. So Matthew 6 and 33. I don't know if they got it. Did y'all get it? Matthew 6 and 33 says, seek ye first the kingdom of God, and it's not my righteousness, his righteousness, and all of these things will be added unto you. Where's my, you know what, I thought about, what are these things? I'm trying to get back to my Watch the Greatest Pastor Ever on Facebook Live. Right now, let's get over here. You know, this might be for somebody else here. Okay. No one can serve two masters. Either he will hate the one and love the other, or he will be devoted to the one and despise the other. All these things will be added to you. If we put God first, listen to this. You cannot serve both God and money. Therefore, I tell you, do not worry about your life, what you will eat or drink, or about your body, what you will wear. Is not life more important than food? And the body more important than clothes? Look at the birds of the air. They do not sow or reap or store away in barns, and yet your heavenly Father feeds them. And you are not much more valuable than they? Who are you, by worrying, can add a single hour to his life? And why do you worry about clothes? See how the lilies of the field grow, and they do not labor or spin? Yet I tell you that not even Solomon, all his splendor, was dressed like one of these. If that is how God clothes the grass of the field, which is here today and tomorrow is thrown into the fire, because you do not know what tomorrow holds for you. Today's the day. O you of little faith, so do not worry, saying, what shall we eat, or what shall we drink, or what shall we wear? For the pagans run after all of these things, and your heavenly Father knows that you need them. But seek ye first the kingdom of God, and all this will be given to you as well. Therefore, do not worry about tomorrow, for tomorrow will worry about itself. Every day has enough trouble of its own. Today is the day of salvation. So I'll conclude with this. Jesus wants a relationship. When you don't put God in his rightful place and take time to have a relationship with God, you will never get to it. And it will get easier to fill your time with stuff. And the last scripture that I want to close with is Colossians 3:2. Set your minds on things that are above. Things that are above, not on things below. So, as we step into this service today, you have plenty of room. Plenty of room. What do you say we just put God first today? Let's worry about tomorrow tomorrow. Let's forget about yesterday and the things that I didn't get done. Let's focus on today. In this moment of time that has been given to you, this is the day that the Lord has made. I will rejoice and be glad in it. So why don't we all stand to our feet? Give God some glory. Give God some praise. As our musicians begin to come, take a minute. Take a few minutes. You got all day. Oh, sorry about that. I got the world on me. Get it off. Get it off. Do it in your Sunday best.
Some of you don't think I need a microphone. Brother James said I needed one, so I better get into the mic here. Look to your neighbor, smile at him real big, say, I'm glad to be here today.
I'm glad to be here today.
Look to your other neighbor, say, better yet, I'm glad you're here today.
I'm glad you're here today.
How many of you are glad that Jesus is here today? Amen. How many of you come to magnify the Lord? Won't you magnify the Lord with me? Let us exalt his name together. Amen. Entering into his presence with singing and inspiration, shall we? Amen. Let's sing along with our crowd now. Look to your neighbor and say, move your lips at the least. Let that be the least. Amen. Make a joyful noise. There you go. Hallelujah. All right, let's sing unto the Lord.
Well, if you're not ashamed to praise the Lord, oh, let me see you clap your hands.
Your feet and wave your hands to leave for
Praise God. In the Old Testament, if one reads, you could read about the time to where that the Ark of the Covenant was away from the presence of the Israelites. And when it finally came back into the camp of the Israelites, they began to shout. And as a result of the shout, the enemy said that the shout or the cry of a king is among them. I don't know about you, but the king is among us here today. And we got every cause and every reason to shout, hallelujah. Amen. Not to say that in our quarantine state and in the time of our absence from this place of gathering, in the gathering within the confines of our home, that the king was absent from there. Because God is everywhere. He's omnipresent, hallelujah. But I can assure you, victory many times comes as a result of the shout.
Right.
Hallelujah. We see that displayed and exhibited through the Israelites prior to their conquering the promise. Amen. And we see that before the walls of Jericho crumbled, amen, as rubble beneath their feet, and they were able to march forward in triumph over the adversary, amen, in the adverse circumstances of their condition. I'm going to tell you right now, regardless of what we're going through, if we just shout it out unto the Lord,
on,
shout unto God with a voice of triumph.
Hallelujah.
Don't wait till victory. Don't wait till the walls of Jericho fall. Don't wait till, hallelujah, because the shout of a king is in amongst us. Hallelujah. The king is here. He is present. He inhabits the praises and the shouts of his own. Amen.
Amen.
Praise God. Praise God.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Oh, I love church.
Amen.
Sister Melody, more than once, my granddaughter has come to me in the last few weeks. Little Claire, she said, Pops, or Bear Paw, it's better in the church. It's better in the church.
Amen.
I miss church.
Yeah.
Hallelujah. It's better in the church.
Yeah.
My Jesus. Oh, what an honor it is to see every one of you. You don't know what it's like for the corral and I to be looking out there, and there's nothing but empty chairs, and there's nothing but a camera you're staring at, and you're thinking, well, are they out there? More than once, I've called it Radio Land. Are you out there in Radio Land? Amen.
I got to tell y'all, y'all may think you weren't effective, but I know four people, two at my job and two in my Dusty's family, that have been watching you every week and telling me, are y'all going to still do this when you start church again?
Exactly.
So you are effective.
Praise the Lord. There's been a lot of prayer go up, and the effectual fervent prayer of the righteous is availing. Hallelujah. There's a lot of preaching that's been going out. Amen. And there are people whose ears would normally be deaf. Amen. And not tune in to what's going on, but to God be the glory. Amen. People are being reached. This is the greatest hope. Hallelujah. The hope whereby we stand on. And it be none other than Christ in us, the hope of eternal glory. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. My Jesus. I think we got some more song. Amen. Let's worship the Lord with them as we before they sing. Let's take up an offering. We've been missing our offerings around here. We're not going to have any ushers take the offering plate to you. We've been instructed that you specifically have to come up here, drop your money, your checks, and those weeks of tithings that you've skipped out on, you can just drop it into the offering plate. Amen. God bless you is my prayer. Amen. As you come giving your offering. Also, we will make by way of reference an announcement that our Ladies, Reflection magazines have come in. Our End Time magazines have come in as well. As always, we will encourage you to read this material. After having read it, please, amen, share this material with others, letting them to know that great things are still taking place, even in the midst, amen, of prophetic events and all that's being fulfilled. Let's continue to worship the Lord in song here today, shall we?
Praise God, praise God.
Will be met. You are still my healer, though I can't see it yet. I am still gonna praise you, and I won't forget who you are. Who you are. You are still my provider, so my needs will be met. You are still my healer, though I can't see it yet. I am still gonna praise you, and I won't forget who you are. Who you are. You are still my provider, so my needs will be met. You are still my healer, though I can't see it yet. I am still gonna praise you, and I won't forget who you are. Who you are.
I'll just
He can do exceeding abundantly above all that which we ask or think, according to the power that works within us. Come on, let's permit and allow the power of God and His Shekinah glory, amen, to be displayed, to be exhibited well within our midst here today. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. My Jesus. Some ask the question, why the ecstasy? Why the excitement? Why does people among Pentecost, and particularly them that have been born of water and of spirit, buried into the lovely name of Jesus Christ for the remission of their sins? It's because we know, amen, what the redemptive power of God has done for us and with us. Hallelujah. It's because we know that it's as relevant now as it was yesterday. It's just as real today as it was 2,000 years ago when the church was initially birthed. Hallelujah. And the church still is in existence today. God can still do. He still does. Hallelujah. He cares for. If you're out there and you're in need of healing, I'm going to challenge you, amen, just to reach out with outstretched arms this morning and call upon that name that is above every name and believe, amen, while calling upon that name in faith, trusting the Lord, amen, to bring healing to your body. Amen. The supernatural power of His Shekinah glory is still at work today. Praise be unto the Lord God. I know what the Lord can do. I know what the Lord can do. Hallelujah. My Jesus. Well, I could see that everyone's passion, for the most part, has not changed. If anything, it's just as forceful now than it was, amen, 2 months ago. And of all of you that were unable to make service today, I know some of you are watching, and our regrets were for you not to be able to come, but we're asking you, amen, just to worship the Lord right along with us. I appreciate our chorale. Appreciate our musicians and the amount of sacrifice that they have made in coming and being with me, not leaving me standing alone. Hallelujah. But they were here right along with me, worshiping the Lord in song and inspiration. And I appreciate the testimony, Sister Melody. I've had more than one tell me that they have loved ones, some as far out as 7,500 miles in distance, some at right at 750 miles in distance, paying attention to what's going on here in Trinity, Texas. Hey, who said we couldn't go global? Amen. Just right here from out of Trinity, Texas. I said 7,500 miles. I don't even know if there's 7,500 miles all the way around the world. I don't know. 8,000, okay. Well, anyways, we'll take it for what it's worth. That's awesome. I made the statement a while ago when that water turned green. I told Brother Brandon, I said, that's what the world will do to you. It'll marginalize you. Amen. It'll turn you into a green-looking monster before it's over with. Just a thought. I'm glad to be here today. We're glad you're here today. It is the pastor's reward to see his people. I try to stay in touch, but it's not the same. You send out text messages, it's not the same. FaceTime, it's not the same. You know, I thank God for the remarkable technology that we have access to today, and it's good. It is good. It beats having nothing. But But it's a joy to be together. Amen. Under one roof, magnifying the Lord together. Amen. Without any further ado, I want for Brother Seaton to come at this time, if he will. What a pleasure it is to have him. He and his young daughter, he all but called her Miss Junior a while ago, because she looks a lot, probably acts a lot like her mother then, I suppose, okay? So it's no wonder that he brought her with him then, because just to keep him in check. Amen. She had to stay home and help out with the music in Beaumont, and they're not having services there yet other than on the platform. I want us to be in much prayer for this nation. Let's pray for this nation. Let's pray for its leadership. Let's pray for revival. Amen. I want us to be in much prayer for one another. Pray for the backslider. This is a great day for the prodigal to come home. Amen. I know I started off with Brother Seaton, and I'm glad he's here. I don't know when he's destined to go or to leave from the States here and then to Germany within 2 months. But Germany needs our prayer as well. He's going to be a missionary there before it's said and done. And we're going to raise up an offering for him, or we're going to give to him to help provide him with something that will be beneficial to him. In Jesus' name, amen, while he's away. Brother Seaton, I want you to take your liberty today. I think when I spoke with him the last time or the time before, I said, look, you can share a little missionary report for us or with us. That's fine and well. But I want you to preach to us. He said, that's what I do. I said, well, that's great. Just come and preach to us today. Amen. Everyone say in Jesus' name.
Amen. Praise the Lord, everybody. Can I move this? Is that okay? I don't know if y'all need two mics for me. I'm pretty loud with one. I'm even pretty loud without one. Good to be in the house of the Lord. I know I'm fixing to basically just pull a magic trick on you because I'm talking really low right now, but when I get to preaching, you're going to think there's a different person here in the pulpit. Lord willing, unless he just wants me to stay silent and takes my voice and y'all just continue worshiping like you have been. But God knows all things. He is, none of this has taken him by surprise, which is kind of shocking in our human abilities. We think because we get shocked, God gets shocked. But none of this has taken him by surprise. And this service here today, he has ordained. He has set this in motion before you were even born. So go ahead and put that in perspective. Before you were even thought of, God said, I've got a service destined in Trinity, Texas, and it's going to happen on a specific day at a specific time, and their world had been shaken, but they're going to show up in that service, and they may have a little worry and a little confusion and maybe some with a little fear, but God ordained and destined this service and brought you here for such a time as this. I want to go into the word of the Lord. I was going to have my daughter say something in German. I was going to say something in German, but I just feel to go ahead and press into the service if you don't mind. We are going to Germany. Our date was June 7th. We've had to push back a couple of weeks due to the virus. I will know more tomorrow when I contact the embassy to find out the opening date for Germany and for travel to Germany. But we are trying to get there as quick as possible. We lack about $16,000 in our budget, and to God be the glory for that. In fact, we've actually had about 5 services canceled during this time. We've had that we were kind of depending on. We've had one sponsor lose his job that was going to be sponsoring us about $1,000 a month, and we were depending on that. And so when I calculated it up before, probably about a month and a half ago, we were looking at about $16,000 to raise then. So here we are, five services missed and a big sponsor not being able to sponsor, and we're still at the same exact place and hadn't missed a beat. That's God. When you can't figure out where it came from and it's there, that's God. When you've been waiting on your miracle and you start calculating and looking at things and wait a minute, there's something there that wasn't there before, that's God. That's when God shows up and says, hey, guess what I can do? Look at what I can do. I can provide mercy. I can provide grace. I can provide love. I can pick you up out of the miry clay. I can put you back on a rock. That's God. That's what God can do. You haven't stopped being God, and I'm not going to stop trusting you. I'm not going to give up my faith and my hope and my desire and longing and my craving to be with you, because you're still God. Lord, help me. It's been 5 weeks since I've preached. I'm a little rusty. Mark chapter 11. I did one online service, and I preached to the entire pews at the Church of Beaumont. While you're turning in your Bible, Mark chapter 11, verse 22, I'll share that with you. March 29th, the last service we had in our sanctuary, and I was elected to preach. I said elected. There was a voting poll, and I was elected. We seat about 1,100 people there at the church. We don't seat 1,100. There is seating for 1,100. Let's not get that mixed up. There's a lot of room in the sanctuary today for people for social distancing. But I got up there to preach, and I felt just an anointing and an unction. I was supposed to be somewhere else. That pastor had to cancel. I was supposed to be preaching somewhere else. I ended up having to stay home. And there was somebody else supposed to be preaching there at Beaumont, and they couldn't be there to preach. So pastor said, you're preaching. I said, okay. I had felt something to preach. And I said, okay, God, you're just going to have to make it happen. And God made it happen. So I walked up to that pulpit with not one person there, just a camera. And I preached with just what I had, and you would have thought the place was full. I'm not bragging. I'm just saying it doesn't matter if somebody's sitting in front of you, or it don't matter if it's just a camera. If God gave you a word, that means somebody's going to get it.
Believe it.
And it was 1 week later, actually just 6 days later, I baptized my daughter in the name of Jesus Christ for the remission of her sins. So even if no one else got it, she got it. And if I can impact the people that live in my home, I've done well. I don't care what anybody else says. If my wife thinks I'm a Christian, I'm a Christian. Let that bless somebody. Mark chapter 11, verse 22. And Jesus answering saith unto them, have faith in God. Look at your neighbor and say, have faith in God. For verily I say unto you, that whosoever shall say unto this mountain, be thou removed, and be thou cast into the sea, and shall not doubt in his heart, but shall believe that those things which he saith shall come to pass, he shall have whatsoever he saith. Verse 24, therefore I say unto you, what things soever ye desire. Somebody shout desire. When you pray, believe that you receive them and you will have them. I want to preach for a few moments this morning, being very cautious and aware of the time, but I want to preach what I feel the Lord has directed me to this morning for Calvary Tabernacle. Desire in the dilemma. Where we are today is not where we thought we would be at the beginning, of 2020. I see the poster on the wall, the 2020 vision of I just can't help it. And that's what Corona said. I just can't help it.
It's right in, brother.
It's not where we thought we would be at this time. But I haven't lost something in the middle of all of this. I haven't lost my desire for a God that's still bigger, for a God that's still greater, for a God that's still stronger, for a God that's still mightier than anything else this world can bring up. I'm talking about a church here this morning that has an understanding. I still got to have desire even in the midst of all of this, because my desire is going to help me push through every obstacle and every dilemma I face in my life. Hallelujah. Would you lay your Bibles to the side? Would you lift your hands? Hallelujah. All throughout this sanctuary. Hallelujah. He inhabits the praises of his people. He is here this morning. His presence is so strong. Would you magnify him? Would you glorify him? Hallelujah. Every part of your being. Would you worship him right now? Hallelujah. Hallelujah. God is still greater. My kids love to sing that song. God is bigger than the boogeyman. You may be seated thinking about that. The rest of the service, go home singing that. Of course, I've got a 4-year-old son. I do dislike traveling alone, but I have my wonderful daughter with me, but I do also like to have my wife and my son with me. My wife is hands down one of the best piano players and singers that I know, and that is no discredit to the wonderful apostolic anointing music you have here. That's just my personal biased opinion. And if by chance my wife somehow gets out of service, finds this recording, and watches it, I want her to know that. Yeah. Amen. Just want to stay safe and saved. Edmund Hillary, a name you are very common familiar with, the man that climbed Mount Everest, that looked at the peak of the mountain, caught a glimpse of it on a day and said, you know, that mountain I will climb. No one else has been able to climb it, but I will set my feet to the mountain and I will climb it. He had another man with him, but they went on their journey as they began to embark upon the journey and the travels of climbing Mount Everest. It was quite the feat to climb. It was something no one else had done before, an accomplishment that only he would have to his name at that time. Maybe there were others that tried to climb it, but they ended up falling or failing. They ended up either going to their death, or they climbed back down the mountain, not being able to reach that point of the mountain that Hillary was after. His autobiography stated that at one point Hillary came upon a difficult rock face. That's what it said. Hillary came upon a difficult rock face. The very next words that preceded was, but Hillary found a way to climb it. That's what I'm talking about in the church. We might come upon difficult and adversity, adverse moments in our walk with God. We may come upon difficulties that we weren't expecting. We had our eyes set on reaching a plateau or a place in the mountain with God, but somehow something difficult came along the way and we weren't expecting it. And it maybe took us off our feet for just a moment, maybe took our breath away for just a moment, but the church and the people of the church and the Christian movement, I'm talking about people of God, have looked at that difficulty and said others might have compromised, others might have given up, others might have walked away, but I've got my eyes set and I might have a difficult place in front of me, but I'm going to find a way to climb it. I'm not going to let this difficult moment, I'm not going to let this pandemic, I'm not going to let COVID-19 make me take a step back. I know my God is still able. I know my God, hallelujah, in whom I will trust. He is able to do exceeding abundantly above all that we ask or think. Hallelujah. I know my God. He has not changed. And if I set my eyes on the top of that mountain, I will go there. I will have desire in the midst of my dilemma. My dilemma's not going to make me take a step back. My dilemma's not going to set me back. My dilemma is not going to hold me back. I will keep stepping. I will keep marching. I will keep racing. I will keep walking. I will keep running. I will keep dancing. I will keep shouting. This dilemma is not going to hold back this born-again man of God. We must have desire in the midst of our dilemma. Just like Edmund Hillary set his face and his eyes towards the peak of the mountain, so we must get our eyes focused on him from whom cometh our help. My help cometh from the Lord who made the heavens and the earth. My eyes are fixed on him. I'm not going to turn to the left. I'm not going to turn to the right. My eyes are set on him. He's the only one that can help me in the middle of this. Yes. Hallelujah. David said this in Psalms 27, "The Lord is my light and my salvation. Whom shall I fear? The Lord is the strength of my life. Of whom shall I be afraid? When the wicked, even mine enemies and my foes, came upon me to eat up my flesh, they stumbled and fell." Most of y'all want to start into breakthrough right now. Breakthrough. You are the God of the breakthrough. Though an host should encamp against me, my heart shall not fear. Though there are difficulties before me, my heart will not fear. Though there are difficult places before me, my heart will not fear. Though there may be an enemy before me, a host against me, thou, my heart will not fear. Though war should rise against me, in this will I be confident. David, what are you trying to say? He sums it up in verse 4. One thing have I desired. Brother Brandon, you talked about priorities. David seemed to get it right. He said one thing. When I start looking at everything around me, I can't get my eyes set on the difficulties. I can't get my eyes focused on what's going on around me. I can't get my eyes set on the deficit. I can't get my eyes set on the shortcomings and the lack of financial things coming into our bank accounts at this time, unless you got a stimulus package. I can't look at that and get focused on that. But if I begin to look up, one thing have I desired of the Lord, and that will I seek after. David, what are you trying to tell us? I got rid of all the other things. I got rid of all the excuses. I got rid of everything else that might have been holding me back. And I desired one thing in all of this. I desired the Lord. And that will I seek after, that I may dwell in the house of the Lord all the days of my life, to behold the beauty of the Lord and to inquire in his temple. For in the time of trouble he shall hide me in his pavilion. In the secret of his tabernacle shall he hide me. He shall set me up upon a rock. That rock I've been looking to climb, he's going to take me there. He's the one. If I get my eyes set, my feet will just start moving. And God's hand is guiding and moving us up the rock. You ain't got it. Some of y'all still nervous. I'll social distance. This rock. Let's go ahead and put it in perspective. Edmund Hillary said, I'm going to climb this rock. I'm going to climb this mountain. No one else has ever done it. He came up on a difficult rock face. Hillary found a way to climb it. You could say that's man's strength and man's desire just to accomplish it. But what about in us when we don't have that strength? Maybe something's just lacking just a little bit. But if we start focusing, look at Peter stepped out on the water. When he started looking at the storm, he sank. But if he'd have kept his eyes on Jesus, guess what? He would have made it. So where are we in this difficult dilemma? Where are we in this time? I'm going to get my eyes set and I'm going to stay focused on him no matter what's going on around me. Because in when my strength fails, his strength is made perfect in my weakness. And when I just begin to walk towards him, I find myself gaining ground that I never would have been able to make on my own. I find myself reaching places I've never been on my own or couldn't get there by myself. I see ministering to people, laying hands on the sick and them recovering. I couldn't do that on my own. But when I got my eyes set on Jesus, when I got my eyes set on the one, the miracle worker, the way maker, the one that can do all things, when I get my eyes set on him, he's the one who does it, not me. It was a month and a half ago. We were in Huntsville, Texas during that time. It was right before everything started shutting down and America went cold. I'm being a little facetious. We were there in service with Brother Clinty for their missions conference. That Sunday, great music, great worship. Presence of the Lord moved in. Felt an urging to get out of my seat. Of course, I wasn't sitting down, but it moved from where I was down to the front. Took a step down to the front, and immediately when I got there, I lifted up my hands. The power of God hit me so strong, and instantly he gave me a vision. Instantly. I saw people in Germany. I reached over and I put my hand on in the vision. Healed. I put my hand on somebody else there in the vision with a crowd of people around. This wasn't about me. It's about what God wants to do. Put my hand over here and somebody received the gift of the Holy Ghost. Put my hand over here on somebody else and somebody else was healed. It's like boom, boom, boom. And there was faces in this vision. And I had never had such clarity in a vision before. But my obedience to come down to an altar, my desire to see God move in all things, God instantly put a vision in my spirit and in my mind of what was going to happen and take place. And I know there may be a time that I come upon a very difficult rock face, but I got a vision of the mountain. I got a vision of the mountain. And I may face a difficult rock place at one point, but I got a vision of the mountain, and I'm going to make that just another step on my journey. I'm going to make that just another step on the mountain. It's going to be just another step in my walk with God, because when I get my eyes set on him, that's all that matters. That's all that matters. So where are we here today in Trinity, Texas? That I would get my eyes set on him. that you would get your eyes and your focus off of everything else going on around you. Brother Brandon, you hit it right in the nail right on the head. We got to get some things pushed to the side. Lay aside every weight and sin which does so easily beset us, that I may run with patience the race that is set before me. I've got to do that, but I can't do it on my own. I got to have my destination in sight. I got to have God my helper. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for you are with me. Thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of mine enemy. You anoint my head with oil. My cup runneth over. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life. I got a vision, and I'm walking towards the vision. Hallelujah.
Yes, sir.
Desire has a tendency to see beyond your current situation. The craving pushes you past obstacles and hindrances to receive what you need. I know there's troubles all around. I know there are trials that you face on a daily basis. I know I am not a robot here before you. I am human. Your pastor is not a robot. He is human. He has faced battles just like you have. Job said, man that is born of a woman is a few days and full of trouble. It's no secret that troubles come. It's no secret that we have difficult times. It's no secret. So while the world may be in shock, the church can say, you know what? God's going to get the glory in all of this. The church can say the gates of hell are not going to prevail against the church, and the church will still stand. The church will still rise. Why? It's been purchased and bought by the blood of Jesus Christ. That's why the church can say in this hour, we are victorious. For we know that troubles come. We know that there are mountains and plateaus, hills and valleys, ups and downs. We know that life comes hard and it comes fast. And it sweeps us off our feet. I'm not talking about a flat tire on the way to work. Or God forbid, the first day you get back into a restaurant and your order comes out wrong. Don't bash that waiter. That's free. I'm sorry. I'm not the pastor. But I'm talking about a difficult place in life that you didn't think you'd maybe able to even overcome. And you looked at that. Well, wait a minute. I got a vision. You said that I could reach it. You set that vision before me. I can't afford to let this difficult hour and this difficult time set me back from what I know you have promised. Even though I don't see it, you're working. Even if I don't feel it, you're still working because you set a promise before me. All I got to keep doing is moving towards the promise. And when I get there, we're going to meet at the same appointed time. Guess what? You are here this morning at this appointed time. And God has set this thing in motion for this day, for this hour. And you are here under the sound of my voice. And God is ready to deliver you. God is ready to set you free. God is ready to pick you up and help you in your time of trouble.
Yes. Yes.
John 16, 33, these things I have spoken unto you, that in me ye might have peace. In the world you're going to have tribulation, but be of good cheer. I have overcome the world. Oh, if you'll just keep putting one foot in front of the other, you keep marching towards that promise, and you still have a desire in your heart, God's going to see you through the dilemma. God's going to see you through the difficult face. God's going to see you through the difficult times. When life gives you lemons and you're unsure how to make lemonade out of your circumstance. I threw that in there. I thought that was funny. You can laugh if you want to. Somebody's going to get helped. We've all been there. What am I supposed to do with this hand I've been dealt? I come from a very sheltered home. Kind of. My parents were adamant churchgoers. And you've heard people talk about it before. You know, they were drugged as kids. Drug problem. I was drugged to church, drugged to the altar, drugged to the prayer room, drugged to the bathroom during service for a quick spanking, and then back in. Thank you. Somebody felt that. I remember the church in Leesville, Louisiana very well. I memorized the steps to the bathroom. I counted them regularly in hopes that we would never make it. Amen. Sometimes those memories come back and I feel them. But for the most part, I've been pretty protected. Would say I've had lived a blessed life. And I'm thankful for the sacrifices my parents have made to get me where I am today. My dad would come home from work. He was in the Army. Come home from work, and I would have to get my schoolwork done before he got done because we were headed up to the church to help finish building the building. Because when he got off work, it was important we made church a priority. And if they were calling on the men of the church to be there, my dad was going to be there. And he was going to make sure his 6- and 7-year-old son was there helping put duct work in for an air system. Some of you might call that child cruelty. And I would too. But I'm thankful that my parents made the church a priority in my life. Yeah. I'm thankful my parents set a path for me to follow. But I've had difficult times in life too. Some of you may look at my difficult times and say, psst, that's nothing. But they were difficult to me. And I didn't know how I was going to get over them. And I didn't know how I was going to make it. And I didn't know how I'd be able to face other people. I'll be absolutely transparent with you here this morning. Can you mind if I'm a little transparent? Okay? I went to Texas Bible College in 2003. I know this is online, so Brother Carter, I love you. Went to Texas Bible College 2003, graduating high school. I remember Justin Daigle. We were enemies, friends. I'm kidding. We were very good friends. Old Andy Gregg, some of my good buddies. Some of y'all are praying. You know, can you believe we're all in ministry? I can't. Have mercy. Lord help. He did help. But it was just 3 years later. I was 3 weeks. We're going to put it all together here. 3 weeks before graduating. And I decided, well, actually, a few months before that, I decided to sneak out of the dorm with about 11 other people. And we played sardines, which you're thinking a minister or aspiring minister to be preaching in pulpits is going to sneak out of his dorm 3 weeks, or this was a few months before graduation, and play sardines with mixed company. I know how that sounds. I can promise you right now, nothing physical happened. But I can tell you it doesn't look good to the administration. That's just a word of knowledge. If you go to Bible college, no reason to sneak out of your dorms and play sardines at night. It just doesn't look good. Let not your good be evil spoken of. I helped somebody. So Brother Cooley, being the president at that time, he said, Jamie, I'm not going to kick you out right now, but I am going to put you on probation. And he said, and if you do one thing, he said, I'm going to have to let you go from the college. Well, I heeded that warning very carefully until about district conference. And it's comical right now. I'm just letting you know. It may seem a little comical right now, but it wasn't funny then. All the staff was gone, and us guys decided to go play basketball a little bit after curfew, right there at the pavilion, right next to the dorms. There was about seven of us guys out there playing. Well, the student body president comes out there and says, hey, guys, you know you're not supposed to be out here playing, and if you'll come in now, I won't tell. Well, thank you, sir. Very kind of you. Well, he told anyways. Very unkind. Well, Brother Cooley looked at me across the desk when he had a meeting with me. And he said, Jamie, I've got to let you go. 3 weeks from graduation, spending 3 years at Bible college, I was devastated because of a wrong decision I had made. So you can look at that however you want to. Sometimes we get to difficult places by our wrong decisions. But nonetheless, I was at a difficult place in life. In that time frame, I spent more time with my pastor, Robert Meyer, in Paris. I'd get up early in the morning and I'd have devotions with him, and I'd work with him all day long. The next morning I'd get up, have devotions with him, and we'd work all day long. Sometimes your wrong decisions can help you get to another dimension in God. I could tell you right now, that may not make sense. I can tell you right now, if I had graduated, I wouldn't have been ready. I wouldn't have been ready. So I had to take a detour because of a bad decision. And I ended up going to Gateway for a semester, making friends, getting myself back on track as well. Came back to TBC. I emailed Brother Cooley. I said, Brother Cooley, could you just let me come back? He said, absolutely. You've served some time away. We'd be honored to have you come back. I said, well, I'm not coming back to just do one semester. I'm going to come back and do a whole year to prove myself. I'm not sure how that looked in his eyes, but I gained some respect. And I'm not preaching for respect here today, but I'm telling you, during a dilemma, if you still got a desire in your heart, you may have some wrong decisions, bad decisions, and you may have had a little bit of a detour, but I'm telling you, if you still got that same desire in your heart, I could have easily said, you know what, God, no. I actually had another pastor. I went to work at the camp just about a month later, and a pastor came into the camp office and looked at me and said, man, what are you doing here? Didn't you just get kicked out of Bible college? I'm talking about shame and disgrace in that moment. I could have utterly just walked away and just hung my head down and just said, God, you know what? It's not worth it to go through all of this. But guess what? I had somebody on my side and I had my eyes set. God, I know this is difficult, but my parents put something in me a long time ago, and I'm not walking away from this. I know I'm embarrassed, and I might be a little ashamed of what I've done, but God, I know you still can use someone like me. And I don't want to ever forget what you've done in my life. And I don't ever want to forget what you're able to do in my life. It was in that same year of Bible college I met Courtney. We had been friends at camp, but something triggered. And I just felt like she was the one. She didn't realize it yet, but I did. And two beautiful kids later, here we are celebrating on July 4th, 11 years of marriage. There's something to be said about somebody who gets their eyes focused. says, I'm not going to worry about voices.
That's right.
I'm not going to worry about the obstacles.
That's right.
It's going to become just another step on my mountain experience.
Right.
It's going to become just another step on my mountain experience. Proverbs 13 and 12 says, hope deferred maketh the heart sick.
Yeah.
But when the desire comes, it is a tree of life. It may be a heartache, but I refuse to let desire die because of my dilemma. A lot of times we get caught up in our unfulfilling present situation. And we look at where we are and we say, it's not where I should be. We look at where we are right now and we say, it's not where I thought we would be. It's called the unfulfilling present. But desire says, I know what it looks like around me. But just like the prophet Elisha said, Lord, if you'll just open his eyes and let him see. And as his eyes were open, chariots of fire and angels surrounding the enemy all around them. Elisha was saying, just open his eyes, Lord, and let him see what's before him that's greater than what he thinks is around him. It might be an unfulfilling present right now, but desire says, go ahead and open your eyes and remain focused on what's before you. That's greater, that's stronger, that's bigger, that's mightier than this present situation. I want to look real quick and I'm going to come to a close if the musicians would come and play. Blind Bartimaeus sat there on the roadside. Jesus, thou son of David, have mercy on me. Jesus, thou son of David, have mercy on me. I know my current situation is rough. And I may not be able to see physically, but I got a vision that today might just be my day. Bartimaeus, what would you have me do, Lord, that I might receive my sight? Your faith made you whole. Have faith in God. Have faith in God. We look at 2 Kings chapter 7. And there are four leprous men during a time of this famine to the people of Samaria. The Syrians had surrounded them. And they were not letting them out of the city to go get food. And Elisha had prophesied of certain things that would transpire. And these four leprous men who couldn't really go into the city because they were outcasts, they said, let us go to the host of the Syrians because if they save us, we live, but if they kill us, we die. But either way, I can't stay here. Because desire will not allow you to be complacent. Desire will help you get your eyes focused and push you towards what God has promised you. But I want to take note real quick in my closing. The king at that time was mad at Elisha. He was furious. A woman had just told him a story that she gave up her son for another woman and her to eat. And the other lady had hid her son so they could not eat him. They were hungry, but they lacked desire. The king lacked desire in the dilemma. And when the four leprous men got to the camp of the Syrians and found that there was no man there, they said, we do not good this day. If we keep this to ourselves, Let's go back and tell the king. And they get back to the king, and the king looks at them and looks at the other people around them. And he says, you know what? It's just like the enemy to try to set us up in a trap, because you can't see what God is trying to do when you don't have desire in your dilemma. When you lack desire in your dilemma, this is how you view things. With skepticism. I believe God can heal and I believe God can deliver. Oh, really? I don't think so. I believe there's people all around the world getting the Holy Ghost. Well, look at the pandemic. This coronavirus has shut us down. We start looking through a skeptical viewpoint. And the king said, that's just like the enemy to try to get us to come out of our city so they can take the city. And he couldn't see that God had already moved the enemy out of the way. And the food was theirs for the taking. They couldn't see that God had already moved in their arena and was trying to get them food. He was trying to provide for them, because four men who were outcasts had enough faith to move in their desire, and they refused to be complacent that an entire city was going to be provided for in a meal. But a king that had no desire said, no, God's not moving in this. Don't be the man in your household that says God's not moving in this. You better believe it doesn't matter. A worldwide pandemic, God is moving in our midst. There are people receiving the Holy Ghost that would have not gotten it any other way. There are people being baptized that wouldn't have received it any other way. But God knew, if there's going to be a worldwide revival, I've got to have a worldwide pandemic. I'll share this story with you and they can play softly. I know this is on live, so I'm going to be very careful. We were in a Muslim country 2 years ago. We ended up baptizing 9 people in the name of Jesus in an apartment building. I've got it on my phone. It's on video. At the same time we were baptizing these people, there was a call, a Muslim call to prayer going on right outside the window. We're baptizing people in the name of Jesus, and there's a call to prayer going on. But those people in that room felt something more powerful than they had ever felt before. These were Muslims going down in the name of Jesus, and the Holy Ghost began to fill that room. My wife began to speak in tongues. The man standing next to her, in shock, in amazement, looked up. His excitement caused me to open my eyes. And as soon as she finished, he couldn't wait to translate what she had just said. He said in perfect Persian, she just said, the world will know who Jesus is. And so when COVID-19 began to hit, I felt that same unction and anointing. And I went ahead. I don't do that often on Facebook. I'd put a little video out. I just wanted to be able to know what took place in that moment, in that country. And I said, if God is wanting the world to know who he is, then it could be this moment and this time for the church to begin to declare on live stream, on Facebook, on social media, on other avenues, the world will know who Jesus is. Stand with me to your feet right now. Because I've got enough desire in my dilemma
to realize there's a mountain before me, and I'm still going to take the mountain. But God, even on this difficult rock face, right now I don't feel like I'm going to be able to overcome it. But God, I know you're trying to work in all of this. I know you're trying to do a work in all of this. Prayer this morning as you come to this altar. I didn't talk to Pastor about this. I think we should still remain a little social distance. I don't know, Pastor, do whatever he feels to do. But my prayer is when you come to this altar this morning that you don't come with this viewpoint. That you don't come with this viewpoint. But you come to this altar and you lay it down and say, God, if you are wanting to do a work in my life, I believe you can do it. If you're wanting to do a work in my family, if you're wanting to do a work in my family, I believe you can do it. If you're wanting to do a work on my job, I believe you can do it. If you're wanting to do a work in this community, I believe, and whatsoever you desire, you will receive. See it, he's moving. Even if you don't see it, he's working. Would you come to the front right now? Would you lay down any cynicism? Would you lay down a skeptical viewpoint? God, I know you're wanting to work. I know you're wanting to work.
I worship
you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop, you never stop working. Stops. He never stops working.
Yes, amen.
Even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. He never stops. He never stops working. Yala robo shata yala wasata. Ala roko to yala robo shata. Never stops. He never stops. He never stops. He never stops. Wonder if that's not why Paul told the church of Corinth, some say not the second letter but the third letter, that we have this treasure within earthen vessels so that the excellency of the power might be of God and not of we ourselves. And then he goes on to say, we're troubled on every side but not in distress. We're perplexed but not in despair. We're persecuted but not forsaken. We're cast down but not destroyed. Always bearing about the dying of the Lord Jesus Christ. So that the life also of Jesus Christ might be made manifest. I'm telling you, there is a manifestation. Hallelujah, hallelujah. He never stops working, even in troubled times. And even in moments of perplexity, confusing times, never stops working. Thank you, brother, for this message today. I want to encourage all our church, the entire church family, all of you that have gathered here today, and for all of you that were unable to come. No, there's around 25 plus in number that we're unable to show, perhaps for various reasons, but our prayers are with you. We're going to continue to pray for one another, encourage each other in the faith. Amen. I appreciate this church family and body. Appreciate your faithfulness. Staying faithful. Brother Gene's faithful to text me almost every day. A little email, or not an email, but a text rather, of a scriptural quote. Now, to some of you, that may not mean a whole lot. But there have been those moments where just that little scripture verse alone was enough to help sustain me throughout the day. And then to have various voices, not heard, but only heard through texting Sister Melody, to encourage you, to encourage me. Let's encourage one another in the Lord. Amen. And when you seem to lack for encouragement, encourage yourself in the Lord. He's always present. He lives in the forever present. Like what Brother Brandon did this morning with that ruler. Stretched it out 6 foot. Said, COVID-19 might keep us 6 foot in distance away from each other. But Jesus, just the mention of his name, 6 foot dissipates. And you could suddenly find yourself embraced within the loving arms of the great master. Hallelujah. Constantly offering to you that comforting source to help sustain you. My, my, my. Don't you wish we had church tonight? Brother Mark's good seeing you. It's not what it seems. Believe this is what the Spirit of the Lord would speak. It's not what it seems. I have operated, the Lord would say, in times past. When it appears as if the enemy has gained, he has only allowed a short time to make such an appearance and an appeal. But rest assured, my spirit is at work, and I will do the work for which none can do. There will be a manifestation of my spirit displayed in this last day. Though it be unrevealing at the moment, revelation will come to pass. And the eyes of many will begin to see clearly. Skepticism will be removed. Doubt will be removed. Unbelief will be removed. People will begin to see as they have never seen before. I believe this is what the Spirit would say to the church right now. Hallelujah. It's not what it seems. It's not what it appears to be through that of human eyes. Amen, amen. Go home, trust in the Lord today. Put your full confidence in his word and allow there to be a manifestation of the life of Christ displayed in your living from day to day. In Jesus' name, amen, amen. Thank the Lord for this great truth. Thank you for being responsive. Thank you for being sensitive to the moving of God's spirit today. God's going to bless you at home as well. Those of you that are out there, lean upon the promises of the Lord and be rest assured that with God all things are yea and amen. Hallelujah. He never fails. He never fails. And he never will. You're dismissed in the fear of the Lord from this place, but not from his presence. You children, y'all just slow down a little bit, okay? We're going to try to do things right here so it won't look too bad. God bless you in Jesus' name. Thank you.